director and a researcher at French National Center for Scientific Research. He is educated in law, Islamic sciences, and political sciences. He has published extensively in the field of sociology and the anthropology of law, legislation, and legal norms activities, especially in the Middle East and North Africa, and in relation to Islam. His recent work involved a phenomenological approach to the production of truths in Arab contexts, including courts and parliaments, scientific expertise, and media and religion education. Today, he will give a lecture on what is Sharia law. My pronunciation is okay. Sharia.
Okay.
It's accepted.
I say. The people in Taiwan are very unfamiliar with Islamic law. However, we have more opportunities to make friends with Islamic countries in the future. And therefore, it is necessary to understand their laws. Professor Zhuker is the expert who can tell us what the Sharia law is. Partly because this law is so unique for Taiwanese audience, we also invite a famous specialist in anthropology of law, Professor Guo Zhuqi, to be a discussion in this seminar. And Professor Guo will share her vision's opinions with us. Now, let's welcome the presentation of Professor Zhuker.
Sharia is an object which is often reified, meaning transformed into an object. And Sharia in itself is not an object, it is a word. So Sharia, as it is often reified, and reified in two among many specific trends. On the one hand, you have the Sharia, which is understood as virtuous abstraction, something which is considered as virtuous mainly by Muslim believers. Not always thought as virtuous. There is a lot of dissent and contest around the concept of Sharia, even inside the Muslim societies. But nevertheless, all in all, it is considered as virtuous. But on the other hand, we have also often, mainly from outside the Muslim world, the Sharia considered as evil, as an evil foil, as something which incarnates barbarianism. Especially, you know, the hands which are cut for thieves and so on, these prejudicial or prejudices and stereotype ideas we often have. I say we because we all belong to non-Muslim worlds. We have regarding the Sharia. Sharia is literally the mundane path that leads to God. This is what the word means. This path, as for many religions, englobes a normative dimension, that is, a set of prescriptions and prohibitions. Sharia is thus a law, but a law with a capital L, not a law with a little L. I use this capital L in order to show that it is of a divine essence. This being said, one has still to explore the sources from which this law derives, their hierarchy, their interpretations, how scholars and believers got hold of it, and the many forms it can take in various contexts. Among the many understandings of the term Sharia, there are two which, although antithetical, respond to each other as in a game of deforming mirrors. One makes of the Sharia, as I say, a virtuous abstraction, a model of behavior, and an intangible norm for the believer.
I'm sorry, I'm not responsible for this for this mess. You can put it in here. Thank you so much. Even though you're late, I want to thank you for all what you do. Inviting me, giving me the opportunity to address this beautiful audience, and thank you to be here. So as I say, law with a capital L to refer to its religious divine essence. Sharia, this is the spelling of the word in English. The correct transliteration is this one. This is the word written in Arabic. So on the one hand, Sharia is a virtuous abstraction. On the other hand, these people who consider the Sharia as the incarnation of backward Islam, the order of values intrinsically opposed to modern civilization. But both perspectives have in common
command to reify, to essentialize the Sharia, to make of Sharia something in itself, an essence, with this paradoxical consequence that it is not so much the sources on which these antagonistic conceptions are drawing which differ, the sources are the same, but the value that is attributed to them, the values are different, but the content is the same. In other words, these two conceptions are the two faces of the same coin, solidary and inseparable, although they are posited to the antipodes of one another. A dispatch of the French television, dated of December the 6th, 2016, can serve us as a starting point. Here is an excerpt, I quote, "The terrorist group Islamic State, ousted from its Libyan stronghold of Sirte last Monday by the forces of the National Union government, had established a daily organization regulated by the Sharia. During more than 1.5 years in this coastal city, ultra-radical Islamists had created the embryo of an Islamic State. With the help of tribunals, prisons, police of good morals, a recruiting center, and a system of tax levy, all ruled by the Sharia, Quranic law was applied to the letter." What can we understand when reading such a dispatch? After reading this dispatch, it could seem that the Sharia is endowed, for the journalist as well as for the partisans of the Sharia, with a clear sense and a precise content. Tribunals, prisons, police of good morals, recruiting center, system of tax levy, Quranic law, the Sharia, and so on and so forth. So it seems that at least for the journalist, but also for the people the journalist is talking about, the Sharia is quite clear-cut, evident. It is made of specific things. Is it the case? This is my question. What is the situation more specifically? The term Sharia possesses for the believer an intrinsic meaning, which it is not my intention to reject or adopt, of course. Even though I don't tell you whether I'm a believer or not, this is not precisely the issue. I might be, as we say in French, réponse de Normand, a Norman answer. Maybe yes, maybe no, and you will never know. So the sole tenable position consists of observing what is said about the Sharia and give an account of this, indicating in what circumstances and how the Sharia is used. In this respect, we must recognize the multiple understandings of the term through time and space, but also from one person to another, and even more from one context to another. Sharia becomes a concept which is accessible to the understanding only if one studies its practical manifestations, while placing aside the question of whether such a manifestation corresponds to the true or the false, the orthodox or the heterodox meaning of the word. So my role is not here to tell you what is the right Sharia. You might ask a Muslim scholar, an alim, known in English as ulama, but scholars of Islam. You might ask him
true or wrong Sharia. Nevertheless, keep in mind that if asking one alim, you will not necessarily have the same answer you would have if asking another alim. So, divine truth is one, but human conceptions of divine truth are many. Two examples can help us to gauge in the variety of understandings of the term Sharia. The first is a personal anecdote. In 1992, yes, I'm not that young, unfortunately. When I was young, having had various personal possessions stolen in my home in Cairo, I took the case to the police. The police was pursued their investigations, and the thief was caught. I was summoned to the central police station in Cairo, and I declared that I had identified the thief after the suspect was shown to me. He asked me, this suspect, to intercede in his favor with the police authorities. Once back in the police inspector's office, I said that I did not want to drop the case, while specifying at the same time that I did not seek vengeance. At that point, the inspector replied directly to me, if we were in an Islamic state and the Sharia was applied, he should have his hand cut off. He is lucky that our civil law is less strict than the religious law, as Sharia, according to this police officer. So you see that conflicting meanings are floating around. It is very hard to find one's path. Another place, other customs, another example. In Britain, a storm of protest was caused by the declarations of the Archbishop of Canterbury, who asked in 2008 that some form of recognition be given to the Sharia in the legal system. A radical commentator seized the chance to prophesy that the banner of the Sharia would one day float over Downing Street. Nobody knows what's the banner of the Sharia, but nevertheless, it will float. Their claims were based on the imaginary figure of 500 conversions each day, with the country destined to have a Muslim majority in the year 2020. At the opposite of the British spectrum, one of the organizers of a large demonstration in London around the slogan "One law for all, no Sharia," this organizer declared that religions are often sources of oppression, but the Sharia is particularly oppressive. However, in ancient times, the Sharia was held to be largely unknowable by most of the thinkers of the classical period of Islam. Sharia referred to divine normativity, and claiming to know the Sharia was as good as taking oneself for the equivalent of God. The idea was that the Sharia is unknowable, non-knowable. There is no access, direct access to the knowledge of the Sharia, because Sharia is the will of God, and knowing, pretending to know the will of God, is pretending to be equal to God himself. This is a fundamental sin in Islam. It is called shirk, association. Associationism in the meaning of associating oneself to God. Most
scholars prefer to speak of their own opinion regarding the Sharia. On the other hand, from the mid-20th century onwards, everyone claims to know what the word signifies and how it must be applied. In contrasting and contested ways, but nevertheless, anyone seems to know what it is all about. That does not mean that there is a general agreement on this signification and how it should be put into practice. And there is a great confusion surrounding the subject of Sharia. Is it customs linked to countries and societies of Muslim migrant populations? This is a question you might ask here in Taiwan. Is Sharia the custom of Muslim people migrating to Taiwan, even though there are not that many? Perhaps do they migrate with their own laws or customs or rules? Is it what the Sharia means? Are they rules? Is it rules deduced from a corpus of canonical texts? Is it law in Muslim majority countries? Is it the political legitimacy of a regime? Is it rules of personal and collective ethics? So is it law? Is it customs? Is it morals? Is it ethics? Is it politics? Personally, I'm not sure that the question, what is religion or what is law, can be answered in a very abstract and universal way. But this was partly, you know, what we discussed during the last 2 days, and so I won't be back to that topic now. At least I know we are not dealing with things in themselves, but uses of words of which certain, not to say many, have a normative signification and are closely related to concepts derived from different languages, cultures, institutions, contexts, and activities. Words and concepts have in common not so much definitions as analogous usages. Usages which are close to each other, which look like each other. Definitions, not sure. When we try to define, often we break our nose on this issue of definition. Words and concepts have in common not so much definitions as analogous usages, which one might describe as a grammar, the way they function together. Religion and law do not belong to a physical world whose terms correspond to external realities. This is not a microphone. This is not a computer. Religion is not a material, does not refer to something material in that sense. Religion, law, Sharia belong to the conceptual world and as such acquire their meaning in the context of their use. Conceptual things, the conceptual world does not float in a vacuum. The conceptual world cannot take meaning but in context, in the practical use of these words. This is true of the term Islamic law as well of that of Sharia. Every attempt to define or at defining academically the concept of Islamic law creates more than it resolves an enigma. Instead of having a correcting attitude, which would lead to state in which sense these definitions are right or wrong, I propose to look at the practical uses of the word, to the ways in which people speak of these words, to the nuances they introduce in their language, to the specific moments they refer to this or that concept, and to what they practically achieve by so doing. The grammar, that is to say, the ordering of terms such as Islamic law and Sharia,
must be examined in the context of use. Words do not possess an essential but only a contextual meaning, and the meaning of words is derived from the circumstances of the use. In function of these circumstances, Islamic law and Sharia can be the reference to Islam in a legal context. Yes, it can be the case. But it can also be a slogan which denounces the illegitimacy, the non-legitimacy, the illegitimacy of a political regime. A concept identified with Islamic normativity before the 19th century, so something historical, ancient, from the old times, but not fashionable today. A symbol of the backwardness of Muslim societies, or a term of constitutional vocabulary. In Egypt, I frequently encounter the slogan "Tatbir al-Sharia," the implementation of the Sharia. It was mainly a slogan coming from the Islamicists, or the Islamists, that is to say, the people using Islam for political reasons. But nevertheless, as a lawyer, or at least having been party trained as a lawyer, I told myself, what does it mean? They are asking for Tatbiq al-Sharia, they are asking for the implementation of the Sharia. It should have a legal meaning, but where will I look for this meaning? So I told myself, I will go on the website of the Muslim Brotherhood. They have a website, as any political party, and on their website, even though they might be liars, but that's not my problem. I don't think, and I don't assume they're more liars than the opposite party. I go on their website, and on their website I should have their program regarding the law, and so regarding what they mean by the implementation of the Sharia. I went on their website and I didn't find anything on the practical content of this slogan. Does it mean that they don't know anything about the Sharia, the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt? Of course not. Many of them are most knowledgeable about the Sharia, or at least parts of the Sharia, aspects of the Sharia. They are much more knowledgeable than I am of Arabic literature and Islamic literature. They know about fiqh, a term I will allude to a little bit later. They know about fiqh, they know about the Sharia, they know about Islam, they know about so many things related to their country and their faith. But they did not find it useful to explain what they understand by the Sharia in legal terms, which means that for them, the Sharia is not that much legal. The Sharia is not a legal issue. For them, the Sharia is a political issue. The Sharia can be a legal issue or a constitutional issue when, for instance, in a constitution like the Egyptian constitution, you have an article 2 which provides that Islam is the religion of the state, the principles of the Islamic Sharia are the main source of legislation. So, constitutionally speaking, that means, legally speaking, there is a reference to the Sharia. So there are places where the Sharia has a legal meaning. But as we saw, in some places the Sharia has no legal meaning, but a political meaning. In other places, the Sharia has a legal meaning and not that political meaning. In other places, like in bioethics, the Sharia has an ethical meaning. What is acceptable regarding ethical principles?
not what is acceptable in terms of law or in terms of politics, but what is acceptable in terms of values. So we see the fragmented, contrasted landscape of this issue. What one can state with certitude is that Sharia is an Arabic word, which means or alludes to divine teaching. It is therefore the divine normativity. It is a normative concept on which, across time and space, a variety of contrasting meanings have been conferred. In this sense, it is a form more than a content. It is the inheritor today of previous practices, and it is the matrix for the new practices of tomorrow, a form more than a content. We have to put issues, relevant issues, into this form in order to make them partly legitimate. It is important to speak in terms of the Sharia. Does it mean that the content of the speech is, you know, rigid, unchanging? No, definitely not. It is flexible, changing, evolving. It is like a soap in your tube, in your tub. It's like a soap in your tub. When it is wet, you try to catch it, but it always escapes your attempt at catching it. This is the Sharia for me, at least. I'm sure many people would contest this controversial metaphor. So it is a form rather than a content. Rather than claiming that the Sharia is something, one can try to demonstrate what one makes it be. So not what it is, but what one makes, one being human beings, make it be. The most frequent attitude towards Sharia is what one could call essentialism. This is the case of numerous scientific works giving the term Sharia a precise signification, which it is claimed would keep on governing Muslim people's daily behavior. But to have spent a huge part of my life in Muslim countries, I can tell you, I can assure you, that the daily life of the vast majority of Muslim people is not governed in the strict sense of the word by the Sharia. It is governed by their daily business. It is governed by their daily concerns. It is governed by the necessity to be in peace or at war with the neighbor. It is governed by the necessity to reproduce oneself, by the necessity to feed oneself, by the necessity to be a human being, by the necessity to communicate with other people and non-Muslim people. Religion is not all governing. Religion is part of the life of the people, but not in this all-encompassing way which is often depicted by scholars. And not only Muslim scholars, social science scholars. And it is important to show, point to these people who also tend to essentialize religion and the behavior of people belonging to certain religions. With an anthropologist, we will have a discussion, and I'm sure it will turn partly around this issue. So this conception of things, which likes to believe that Muslims are genetically determined in their relationship to Sharia, is unsurprising when it emanates from a dogmatic discourse of, for instance, Muslim scholars, the ulama. It is untenable in the universe of human and social sciences, which ought never to accept historical and religious determinism. And therefore, the idea that human beings are conditioned by their religious law. And this is a claim I can do wherever we are, and whatever the religion is at stake. So I can do it here also in Asian countries of which I don't know anything, except that the people are very friendly and welcome, but of which I can tell you nothing because I really have no experience and no knowledge about it. But nevertheless, I can tell you that in your own country, whatever your religion, you are not totally governed by your religion. This is, if there are laws in you in social sciences, which I doubt, this is among the main laws we can discover. Theories of incorporation make Muslims the instruments of this law, whereas a practice-based approach, art approach, should maintain that the authority and the influence of the Sharia must be understood in context, studying who and what was involved and in what circumstances. Rules and conduct can't be dealt with separately. There are nothing like rules in the books on the one hand, practice on the other hand, as if practice were totally and unidirectionally determined by the rules. This is not a one-way ticket from rules to practice. This is wrong. Rules and practice are the two sides of the thing of the same thing. There is no practice without a reference to a rule. There is no rule without the practice of the rule. Otherwise, it's only ink on a sheet of paper, nothing more. So, rules and conduct can be dealt with separately. Sharia regulation is not as these authors depict it. It is neither independent of practice, nor does it possess a predetermined, clear sense. As we lawyers very well know, a rule must always be somehow interpreted. Some interpretations are quick, easy, and are non-reflexive. The green light on your pedestrian way. There is no need, and we don't need interpretation of this rule anymore, because it becomes a reflex, it becomes a habit, a custom, something unreflexive. But nevertheless, you know, rules never contain all their future interpretations. So there is no predetermined meaning of the rule. There is no clear sense in advance. We never know how much this rule will be interpreted in this or that way. Neither does it determine behavior in a univocal way. Religious norms, like other norms, are a practical construction, and their authority derives from the power that human beings attribute to them. So the term Sharia is polysemous. It is an amalgam which captures the imagination of journalists and politicians as well as researchers, and leads them to confuse law founded on the Quran and the prophetic tradition, the norms of fiqh, the codified law of Muslim states, and the customary law of Muslim communities, among other things. From this, there results a form of certitude about the content of the Sharia, which in turn raises simple norms to divine status, with the aim of countering what is seen as the secular form of other dispositions. So we have a strange process. norms originating in the sacred books being contested? Norms originating in customs more than in the sacred books being transformed into divine regulations? It is difficult to know what the term Sharia means precisely. And one realizes that it is accompanied by affective, emotional, moral and normative associations, which are sometimes positive and sometimes negative. The upheavals affecting numerous Arab countries during 2011 have put the question of the Sharia back on the agenda. Whether in Libya, Egypt, or Tunisia, to take only these three cases, Sharia has been invoked by some or used as a bogey by others. In all these situations, a common feature emerged. The term is seen as self-evident and its meaning is never questioned. Because it is seen as evident, it is used as a resource for the construction of discourses of Islamophilia, the love of Islam, or Islamophobia, the hatred of Islam, apologetics or denunciations, authenticity or alienation. In fact, Sharia ends up connoting many things while denoting nothing. It is also true of a multitude of terms imported from a foreign language or loosely translated and which have sometimes entered the dictionary. Fatwa, qadi, mufti, mullah, ulama, imam, jihad, ayatollah, and so on.
Just to put a couple of them. Fatwa, mufti, which is derived from fatwa, ulama, we had it, imam.
Imam is often used to refer to a prominent figure in Islam. And it means, by the way, the one who stands before, you know, in front of. So, but Imam is also Imam Khomeini, once again, because he's the leader. Or Ayatollah Khomeini, which is a specific level in the Shiite hierarchy. She is one of the families of Islam. So, and jihad, I'm sure you have heard about jihad. No? You're not astonished. Sorry. Jihad, the holy war. You know,
Muslim people have a knife beyond the teeth, and they are conducting the holy war, which is called jihad. Nobody knows that jihad comes from the root jihad, which means effort.
Struggle,
but struggle not necessarily armed struggle. So there are two jihad. Jihad by the sword, or the jihad by the tongue, the jihad of nafs, which is the spiritual quest, struggle in order to promote Islam, but not the violent quest for Islam. Anyway, my point is not to say that these conceptions are correct or wrong. My point is to say that we have many words like them, you know, in English, in French, perhaps in Chinese, which were not translated, which were directly used. And why are they directly used without being translated? Because precisely, they connotate much more when not being translated. They convey meanings with the plural, many diffuse meanings without denoting one specific meaning. So, whether in the language of origin or in translation, these words say more than the definition which the dictionary gives them. They transport modes of thought which often function in order to repeat certain representations of the world. Weltanschauung. The connotative effect of words of the Sharia is not limited to its Western usages. Far from it. One should underline that the Sharia has become an ideological term before being legal, religious, ethical, or deontological. Sharia marks how the political space demarcates the factions which struggle for the exercise of power, polarizes societies in the ways that they identify themselves in the eyes of the rest of the world. This is not based on content, but on a mechanism of reference which imposes itself. Beyond these processes of glorification or jabalizing, the content of the reference is evanescent. It is alternately the ideal character of the city governed by Islam or the symbol of its backwardness, which is underlined. Even in Muslim societies, if you have a look at what happened in Tunisia after the year 2011, the issue of the Sharia became very prominent. Do we have to include a reference to the Sharia in the constitution or not? That was the question. On the one hand, you had the Islamist party, Ennahda, which was at that time promoting the inclusion of the Sharia within the constitution. And on the other hand, you had secularists within Muslim societies who were violently contesting this inclusion. So it is contesting the place of the Sharia is not only a Western versus, including Taiwan, Western, you know, a Western versus a Muslim issue, versus Islam issue. This question is very much about a polarization that takes place also within Muslim societies, or so-called Muslim societies. If you allow me to put something into bracket, an interlude, why do we call them Muslim societies? Why do we call them Muslim societies? I am calling you Confucian society.
looks like being strange to you. What does it mean to call you Confucian society? It means that the principle of Confucianism, of which I don't know anything, but point. The principles of Confucianism would determine the nature and the features of your society and you as members of this society. So it means that among the many features characterizing your society, there is one which is much more prominent than the others. This is the one that characterizes your society as a whole. And in your case, it would be Confucianism. This is what we do when calling them Muslim societies. We are claiming, by so doing, that what determines these societies is Islam before anything else, and above anything else. As if the principles of Islam would determine everything which is done within these societies. So I guess you get my point. But keep in mind that this is not only a process we as non-Muslim people are often doing when calling them Muslim people. This is also what people within so-called Muslim societies are frequently doing, because they want to promote Islam. But promoting Islam does not mean, is not equal to being totally regulated by Islam. It is not because you want to push Islam forward that you are totally ruled by Islam. So it is an ideological trend today for Islamists, mainly, to say that Islam is what rules and determines their society. Does not mean that actually these societies are wholly and fully determined by Islam. Often, therefore, the divine law is defined less by a stable content than as a reflection of a political attitude and a way of being, which consists of saying and doing as others in certain domains. Referring to the Sharia is therefore a type of conformism in Muslim society, one all the more solid because it refers to the divine prescription, which it is difficult, of course, to criticize lightly. Reference to the Sharia divides the world into two parts, between the respectable and the others. This is a politically productive distinction, and since it contributes to legitimize or delegitimize actors, that's why it is often used in Muslim societies. It is a tool, a political tool, in order to legitimize yourself and to delegitimize your foes. In addition, in the Muslim context, the Sharia enjoys credibility and acceptance. Not general credibility and acceptance, but a wide general credibility and acceptance. And not for merely political reasons, because many people consider the Sharia as part of everyday life in Muslim societies. So what one understands by the term Sharia is certainly not identical from one person to another, from one corner of the world to another, but it is nevertheless true that in Muslim settings, at least, the Sharia is mainly a respectable reference that anyone can appropriate. Using the Sharia in politics is therefore natural. It is an available resource. That's why it is used so widely. And it is both natural and effective, efficient. When you use the Sharia, you have a strong political weapon in your hands. So on all sides, we as scholars, rather than struggling to define the essence of things, it seems important to seek what they mean when they are invoked. That does not tell us what the thing is in itself, but what people associate with this thing. This methodologically agnostic posture enables me, instead of imposing a transcendental and intangible truth to understand human phenomena. I claim I'm not able to understand divine truth. I claim that I can understand the way human beings refer to divine truth. With regard to the Sharia, everyone seems constantly obsessed by the wisp of its definition. It is true of those who make a foil of Sharia as well as of the guardian of the law, who claim to know the norm in its timeless truth. However, if one looks closer, Sharia is often nothing more than this virtuous abstraction I was referring to, a moral slogan with positive connotations. What Muslims need, everything that is good for them, the Islamic conception of the good. It matters little in a certain sense what that means in practical terms. Sharia is no longer understood here as a collection of precise and specific constraining rules, but an identity-related reference embodying the virtue of the Islamic way. The Sharia is nothing specific. It is the incarnation of what is considered as good if you want to behave as a Muslim. In all the very fuzzy meanings of this definition. In non-Muslim countries, those who want to identify with this virtuous abstraction, Muslim migrants for instance, will often privilege certain sectors of ordinary life on which they consider their ethical militancy. So there are people claiming, asking for the right to live their own Sharia. These domains are those of ritual, finance, family, and social relations. They have only a tenuous connection with the positive law. The question of sexual relations outside marriage, for example, receives massive attention by the supporters of an application of the Sharia. While positive legal reflection in Europe has broadly disengaged from this question. So the law about out-of-wedlock relationship is more or less silent nowadays. But the partisans of the Sharia are very much noisy about this issue. You can see once again that there is a distinction between the law, the morals, virtue, the legal, and so on. Islamic finance is perceived as the means of respecting the Quranic interdiction of usury. I say Quranic, I'm not sure you know what it is all about. Quran, sometimes in English, Quran, or sometimes Quran. This is the Holy Book. I will be back on this issue if you allow me. I'm taking too much of your time in a couple of minutes. But so, there is in the Quran a provision forbidding usury. Usury, not interest, not bank interest, usury. Islamic finance is perceived often as the means of respecting the forbidding of usury. But the organization of Islamic finance consists of an offer of banking products whose legality does not have its origins in Muslim and religious considerations. So, it was not that difficult to find ways to make finance Islamic because these techniques are already available. It is just a way to disguise existing techniques into something Islamic. Finally, the respect of certain dietary interdictions or rules relating to the slaughter of animals is a matter only for believers. How should the animals be slaughtered? It is a matter for believers, but not for legislators. From the moment that public regulations in the domain of hygiene are respected. So positive law in these states is completely indifferent to relations between religious confessions, apart from condemning discriminatory practices which go against the principle of equality. But it is not about the content of faith. It is not about the content of religions. It is about discrimination or anti-discrimination provisions. These areas of Sharia belong to morality rather than to law, nowadays. It is an order or even a disciplinary obsession. It involves regulating one's life as a believer according to the precepts of a revealed norm. It does not concern those who could be described as sociological Muslims. You have in mind this, what it means, sociological Muslims? People who are called Muslims because they belong to the same ethnic community, even though this is not properly speaking an ethnic community, but who are not believers, who somehow don't care about Islam as a faith. Sociological Muslims, nevertheless, as ethnically Muslims, as ethnically Muslim, care about their ancestry, their sociability, their familiarity, the fact that during the so-called Ramadan month, most of the people are fasting, whether they believe in God or not, but they're fasting because this is a social and family habit, and therefore they want to belong to the community, but not as believers, but as ethnic family members of this community. So Sharia, thus understood, concerns practicing Muslims, not or non-practicing Muslims, who aspire, no, I'm sorry. So we have two types of Muslims. We have practicing Muslims who aspire to orthopraxis, what we call orthopraxis. That is the accomplishment of the rituals and the prescriptions of religion. And we have also sociological Muslims or believers who are not that much interested in the practice of the rituals and the commandments of their religion, but want to participate in the life of the community. The call for Sharia has often become an identity-related demand, a rallying point for those who live in a sort of pluralism where majority and minority cultures coexist, and who construct the object of Sharia as a point of convergence for everything that might seem to constitute their being in society. Marriage, circumcision, burial, festival, Ramadan, diet, and so on. I have so many sociological Muslim friends who don't eat pork and drink wine. And this is not because of religious belief, because of conviction, because if this was the case, they wouldn't drink wine either. It is much more because there is a kind of ethnic, quote unquote, ethnic attitude toward the dirtiness of pork. A feeling that pork is dirty, not a feeling that pork is forbidden by God, but a feeling that pork is dirty. Like for me, I'm sorry to say, eating dog would be dirty. But if you present me some piece of dog, I myself don't care. That's not the issue. But as a normal Belgian or normal French, normally I would consider eating dog as dirty, not because
God told me it is forbidden because, or anthropological constitution in Europe makes us consider pork as dirty. The same holds true with regard to my friends considering eating pork. So you, the Chinese society, might be offended by this attitude. Both attitudes, regarding pork and dog. But my point is to say that, yes, definitely, you might consider that eating pork is dirty, but not because of religious reasons. We are not here in the scenario of orthopraxis, because people's relations to religious laws is much more flexible, if not even absent. It is much more flexible, occasional, and cultural. So be careful. Religion is not necessarily culture. Often we say, oh, religion, this is culture. No, there are differences between culture and religion. Not everything in religion is culture. Sharia constitutes a general norm which provides a framework for the organization of these events in a more or less vague fashion. It is not known whether or not these events derive from Islamic prescriptions or local custom. One encounters again the idea of virtuous abstraction, except that this conception of Sharia does not involve only practicing and convincing believers, but also these sociological Muslims, who may not believe and however wish to observe a certain number of precepts traditionally associated with Islam. How much time do I still have? In order not to bother you too much.
Yeah.
Is it 20 minutes, or is it too much? I'm a very talkative.
Remember your train ticket.
Is there a specific schedule?
I cannot change your train ticket, so
okay.
Be fast. It's going to time out later.
All this being said, I want to give you a couple of specific things regarding the Sharia. I think you need also some positive information, not only relativist information. All this being said, if I had nevertheless to summarize the Sharia in a few words, I would say the following. Sharia, as we saw, is firstly an Arabic word which does not have its own clear, obvious, and universal meaning. Grasping the meaning of the Sharia means imperatively discussing it in context. We have seen it. It is the perspective of the nascent Shafi'i school in the 9th century of Baghdad. Is it this good picture of the Sharia? Or is it the picture of Jalal ad-Din Rumi in 13th century Konya? Or is it the context of the Ottoman Empire at the reformist Tanzimat period in the 19th century? A period that can be roughly compared to the Meiji era in Japan? Or is it the Egyptian context of the Muslim Brotherhood government after the 2011 upheaval? Is it a question of doctrinal production, judicial practice, or political demands? We have seen already how much the term Sharia derives its meaning from the ways it is used. The traditional viewpoint, however, has been that the Quran and the tradition of the Prophet, i.e. the narrative of his acts and words, are the two pillars of Islamic law. The Quran, we have seen it, is the sacred book revealed by God. As it took definitive form in the 50 years after the death of the Prophet Muhammad. Be careful. It is said
the Quran is the direct utterance, the direct and unmediated words of God. But nevertheless, we have historical evidence that the Quran, as we know it today, took its definite shape 50 years after the death of the Prophet, which is, for critical reasons, important. For historians, it is important. The tradition of the Prophet, what is called the Sunnah, is the corpus of sayings and doings of the Prophet, as it accumulated over two centuries from the time of the Prophet onwards. Be careful again. This time it is not only 50 years, it's 200 years before the compilations of the traditions were achieved. Both the Quran and the tradition are only marginally concerned by prescription and proscription, what is recommended and what is forbidden. Be careful, it means that Islam is not law. It is only partly, marginally normative. The sacred book and the tradition are, above all, composed of elements of mystical inspiration, moral exhortations, and edifying stories. They reflect the context of the revelation of the Quran to Muhammad, the Arabia of the 6th and 7th century, and the life of the Prophet, who transformed himself from preacher to a head of an incipient religious community. In addition, these two main sources of the Sharia in the course of their constitution, as well as after their final fixing, have always depended on the readings proposed by their respective specialists. What one can think here in particular of the important tendencies within which Islam was represented by Shiism and Sunnism, and the four main Sunni schools, Maliki, Hanafi, Hanbali, and Shafi'i. Shiism, Sunnism.
I leave aside the four schools.
If interested in this field of inquiry, there is a book I wrote, which will be very soon published, and which is on which I draw my presentation, and in which you can find all this information. References to the Sharia are not frequent in the Quran. In reality, early Muslim scholars did not evoke the Sharia and did not claim to know it. Writings on Islamic normativity from the 9th century onward assume the features of a particular form known as fiqh. The best translation one can give of this term is that of doctrine. That is a set of principles that are taught by the scholars of a particular group. Treatises of fiqh are always concerned in the first place with ritual obligations associated with Muslim devotion. These are the five pillars of Islam: the profession of faith, ritual prayers, almsgiving, fasting, and pilgrimage. Secondly, these treatises are concerned especially with family relations, an area on which Islamic rules concentrate: marriage, divorce, filiation, succession. It is among these family-related rules that one finds numerous prescriptions and proscriptions that are debated today. So this is only in a tiny part of the Islamic teaching that one draws today in the field of family law, mainly. This is where you find issues related to the rights such as the rights of guardians of women, the endowment of wives by their husbands, the authority of husbands, the unilateral right to dissolve a marriage, what we call repudiation, the imbalance in the duties of wives and husbands, and unequal inheritance rights determined by gender. So, you see, there is a history of fiqh more than sharia in two main families, two main trends, Shiism, Sunnism, and among each of these two families, you have also various sub-trends and different interpretations. But what is called Islamic law, and I will end with this, because otherwise I'm afraid I will be totally out of, and I will foreclose your discussion. What is called Islamic law does not correspond to a reality as ancient as Islam itself. The idea of transforming norms into positive law, this is what I have in mind, and I think what you have in mind when speaking about law. Law today became positive law, and it is so difficult for us to understand law if it is not positive law. And this holds true with regard to Islam. The idea of transforming norms into positive law, and in particular into codified law, is the result of an invention. An invention. Islamic law is an invention as a law. An invention rooted in the European intrusion onto the Muslim scene. And I think the same holds true in this area of the world. Encounter with European, not only the encounter in the broad sense of the word, not only imperialism. For instance, in Japan, there is no direct imperialism, and at least there is no colonialism. Nevertheless, the Meiji era is characterized by the adoption of codified law, which transforms normativity in Japan into Japanese law. This is my point with regard to Islam. Oriental scholars and colonial administrators on the one hand, and Muslim rulers and new elites on the other, and this is very important to have it in mind, sought in fiqh materials susceptible of being poured into the mold of the Napoleonic-style law codes. This grafting process was successful, and today the notion of Islamic law is considered as natural. It is evident, self-evident, but historically speaking, it is not evident. It is a specific production of a specific time which transformed the local normativity into positive law. Sharia, therefore, was partly codified, especially in the era, in the area of family relations, with which it is particularly concerned. The term of personal status, which is used to describe this family-related legislation, is most speaking in itself, as it does not originate in the fiqh language, but in the civil law distinction between real status and personal status. So the word, which is in the domain of law, which is considered as the most Islamic and the most related to the Sharia, is identified with a word, with an expression, which originates in the Napoleonic civil law and not in the Islamic legacy. There are many places where the fiqh continues to exercise an influence, but case to go into the details, and the broad process is that more or less Islamic normativity was transformed into Islamic law through this encounter with the West, broadly speaking, and the rationalistic attitude, ideology, I should say, of the 19th century and the early 20th century. Science often makes simple things complicated. I have tried to do just the opposite and to make complicated things as simple as possible. I'm not sure that I have succeeded, but I can assure you that what I did